Have you seen our spark? No? Please look first at our spark, because the theory of this video will give you a hint for the solution. We have to memorize that the mechanical energy can be converted into thermal energy. Think about engines where heat is released or the brakes of your car. In this video, we will focus us more on the mechanical energy balance in a particular, in a special way. What did the mechanical energy balance look like? We have seen that the total energy balance of an open system, this means a volume with an inflow and an outflow of fluiding, heating elements and a stirrer, can be written as the sum of the mechanical energy balance and the thermal energy balance. You immediately see the occurrence of the friction loss terms EFR multiplied by the mass flow rate in both balances. Both parts compensate each other. If you convert mechanical energy into thermal energy, the thermal energy will increase while the same amount of energy will decrease in the mechanical energy balance. Let's zoom in on the mechanical energy balance. I told you before that we will look at a special form of the mechanical energy balance, but not an important one. It was Daniel Bernoulli, one of the members of the famous Swiss Bernoulli family, who was the founder of the so-called Bernoulli principle. The principle is based on a simplified energy balance, but explains the underlying mechanism of many technologies of the 20th century. Examples are the so-called carburetor, wings of airplanes, mass flow measurements devices, and explains the phenomena demonstrated in our spark. The simplification of the mechanical energy balance lies in the fact that under steady state conditions, the friction losses are neglected. Let's look at the mechanical energy balance again. Let's now look at the steady state situation where we neglect the friction losses and the contribution of the stirrer to the system. This gives us a reduced mechanical energy balance. Dividing by the mass flow rate gives us the following equation. This equation is valid for any point between the inlet and between the outlet of the system. This result is often used to explain or to solve many engineering problems. Let's illustrate Bernoulli's principle by an example. Consider a horizontal pipe where a liquid flows through a contraction. At point 1 in the pipe, the local pressure is P1 and the local velocity V1. We also look at the same horizontal plane at the point 2, which is located in the contraction, with a pressure P2 and a velocity V2. The velocity V2 is much higher than before the contraction. However, as a result of Bernoulli's principle, the local pressure at P2 is lower than P1. This is probably a little bit against your initial feelings, because you think that the velocity is higher and consequently the pressure is higher. This was a major achievement of Daniel Bernoulli, who showed that energy at both points stay constant. Today we apply Bernoulli's principle to measure the flow rates in a tube or in a modern aircraft to measure the velocity of the plane. If you realize that it was in 1738 that Daniel Bernoulli published this principle in his book Hydrodynamica, it was at that time a major achievement, and it is still amazing that 3 centuries later we still use and apply his ideas. And do you have the answer of your spark? Not yet? Make the exercises and you will understand the Bernoulli principle. Thanks for your attention.